Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Argumentative Indians. Today, we're asking the question, is Indian heritage better off in foreign museums? Dan Hicks, in his work, The British Museums, that deals with the Benin bronzes, colonial violence, and cultural restitution, writes in the preface of the book that any museum object has a double historicity. Of course, its existence before and after the Act of Accession. In the context of a discussion today on whether Indian heritage is better off in foreign museums, Hicks' statement brings us to question various things. The meanings historical objects have originally, and the meanings they may acquire in the process of their migration, how they're taken away from their contexts and museumized, how do former colonies perceive these objects in contrast to the gaze they're subjected to by countries that colonized, and also, what exactly do we do with these historical materials? To answer these questions and to touch upon themes of cultural restitution, repatriation, museumization, the sacredness of antiquities, history and geography, and many more interesting arenas, we bring to you this important discussion answering the question, is Indian heritage better off in foreign museums? I'm Eric Chopra, your moderator for the evening, and I'm extremely honored to be joined by our esteemed panelists today. Dr. Jyotindra Jain, historian of Indian art and culture and a museologist. Dr. Naman Ahuja, professor of Indian art and architecture at Jawaharlal Nehru University and the editor of Marg magazine. And Mr. Anurag Saxena, public policy and advocacy expert and founder of the Indian Pride Project. So to start off, let's begin with the opening statements from our guests, answering the very question on which this debate has been a theme today. Is Indian heritage better off in foreign museums? Starting with Dr. Jain.
Yeah, I think the whole topic of Indian heritage abroad or world heritage abroad in museums, particularly in the museums of those countries which had colonized half the world or nearly the whole world, it has come into focus recently in the recent decades very much because of tremendous focus that is, what has come into focus is the colonial and post-colonial studies, which are like in last 20, 30 years, particularly in the academia, has acquired tremendous importance. And that has also led to awareness about objects that have been plundered in colonies to and are housed in Western Museum. Now, this has become a very contentious topic. And the reason for this is that there is a lot more awareness that is coming up. So much is being published about this in the university. So much theorizing has happened about post-colonialism and things like that. This has all led to creation of certain awareness about the ethical aspect of museum collecting. Particularly, I think in the 18th century, in the era of Enlightenment, that was a time when geographical discoveries were made all over the world. New knowledge was coming into Europe, and they were responding to these. And while this new knowledge about the rest of the world that was coming in, I think a lot of material that was being collected, even plundered, forcibly taken, had come into Europe. And it was a kind of randomly collected material initially. And that had led to the coming of curiosity cabinets and things like that. And then I think two or three major things like the Benin bronzes in Africa, for example, 5 lakhs of African cultural objects are abroad, 5 lakhs. Hardly 3,000 objects of any importance are still in Africa, but they have put a claim to these. Then there was also the question of Elgin marbles that were nearly half of Parthenon, and a lot of other things were taken away, and the whole for more than 50 years a claim has been put and nothing has been returned, but at least a dialogue has begun in this regard. Egyptian objects are also in many collections, and Egypt has also put. The thing is that India has not even thought of putting together a basic inventory of what is abroad. Leave aside claiming and getting it back and whether those objects are better off there or better off here. Before that, we don't even have one inventory of what is abroad from Indian art. So I think that some kind of provenance research is required. And for that, I think an institution has to be created with researchers and things, and just to know what is where. And then I think there'll be a question of ethics and colonial collecting practices, rise of museum and things like that. So I feel now as we go along, we will discuss the issue whether the objects are good, they are good abroad rather than here. But I don't want to put everything in one go now. So let us begin and then we'll come back to the issue of whether these objects should remain abroad or should come back to India and many other issues. So just to say that there is all over the world, the museums are nearly shattered because of this new debate that has come up about museum ethics. And this has really shattered big museums. They are very worried. They are feeling guilty. They feel that as if something ethically wrong. And there's a lot of polarization on this. So we'll come to all this as we discuss further.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Jain. I would now like to go to Dr. Ahuja with the same question, and also given the context that Dr. Jain just gave, India has not even thought about putting together an inventory to understand what artistic materials are in these foreign museums. So what do you think about this, Dr. Ahuja?
I completely agree with Professor Jain. I think that we certainly need to start making much more detailed inventories, and provenance research is a subject that has to be taken much more seriously in South Asia. There are some stories about claims being made by India and Indians. And the stories, if we build up the case studies of what we have claimed in the past, how we have claimed it, what were the grounds for claiming it, that doesn't paint a very noble or an interest or an important picture for us, because our claims have been very opportunistic, and we are not going about it with a clear policy perspective. We are going about it in a very ad hoc manner, where jahan haath lag gaya, what you can grab and how, and it suits a certain media industry at a certain moment, we grab that and we utilize it for a certain hype. But after that, what has happened with that object? What was the point of its restitution? What was the purpose behind which we did it? Those ethics on our own side seem to not be very consistently followed. So I think it would be very wise for us to do as Dr. Jain is saying, that first make an inventory and decide look at the complexity of the project at hand. Now, I'll share something with you. In the 1950s, the post-colonial India, soon after independence, did make a request to have a number of interest groups in South Asia were lobbying for the repatriation of a large number of objects from South Asia that had been taken by the British Empire. And at that time, a very clever response came, which said that when the things were taken, they were taken from an undivided Hindustan. So why don't Pakistan and India, at that time, including East Pakistan also, make up their minds, draw up your provenance list, give the British the list, saying what belongs to who, and then the British government could possibly consider that. Because who is the rightful claimant? Is it Lahore who is the rightful claimant? Karachi, the Northwest Frontier, now the nation state of Afghanistan and India and Bangladesh, like who is the rightful claimant of something? And then with some things which are from the Nepali Tarai and things, it's even more confusing when it comes to some Chola bronzes. it's very confusing because you don't know whether it's a Sri Lankan one or whether it is an Indian one. And it does become confusing because there isn't adequate record. Now, is India going to then be Big Brother and claim it on behalf of the rest of South Asia? Is there going to be some internal organization between South Asian countries to be able to house these objects? What are the modalities by which we are going to repatriate, right? That's going to be the next issue that we have to discuss. Linked with provenance research, which I think, by the way, is essential. None of this is denying any of these issues. But in order to file a claim, there has to be an interested party that believes that they are the rightful claimant, right? That's the first thing in fighting, in making a claim. Now, who is the rightful claimant, right? That's what I'm trying to hint at. That's the problem, because we haven't done our provenance research adequately. We are on a back foot invariably about making a claim. This is added to by a certain problem, which is a unique problem that we find ourselves in, which is one of the pillars of post-colonial studies has been diaspora studies. And it is linked with a very clear agenda for the idea that the 20th century colonization of the world led to very significant population displacements in the world. So a large number of South Asians became native of Fiji or Trinidad, and subsequently became natives of South Africa or of Britain and Canada. And all of these things began to move around. Then we started seeing mixed identity cultural creation. Now today in India, anything by law which is more than 100 years old is regarded as an antiquity. So a lot of early modern Indian art, whether it was made in Shantiniketan or made by Amrita Shergill or whatever, would be regarded as being antiquity very soon, right? Now that's something that we are confronted with. So what happens as a result is that a lot of the legal frameworks that cover art and its repatriation are actually is now going to reflect on the high ticket numbers, which actually have the greatest value in the art market, which are the great modern artists and so on, are a product of globalization. They are a product of migration and movement or mixed race identities or cultural hybridity. So the big ticket numbers that the art market is really interested in, which are the high value artworks, are actually things which are a product of that kind of a milieu. And that puts another complexity, that who is the claimant? Is Hungary going to be claiming the work of Amrita Shergill? Is Italy, or where she's trained, or France, where she's trained, going to be claiming the work of Amrita Shergill? Is India going to be claiming the work of Amrita Shergill? Like, what happens? What are we going to look at? So I think the question of whose art is it is a very big and a serious question that we need to take on board, because it's not a simple answer. Who is the rightful claimant? I can give you richer examples on this theme, but it's a theme that I would like to come back to,
yeah,
as to whether a land has a claim on an artwork, or does a culture have a claim? And if it is a culture that is making a claim, then that culture need not be located to that geography. The culture can be shared within a larger geography. And if culture is something which is not bound by geographic identity and place, then you're opening up the discourse that Tibet can exist in India. You are allowed to then say that, because otherwise you're not allowed to say that. Otherwise you have to say that only China can claim Tibet. And that's been a terrible position for Tibet to be in. And The minute you allow culture to move beyond the geographical space of its manufacture, then you are opening up a much more sophisticated conversation about history and claimants.
Thank you, Dr. Ahuja. Now, he touched some very important themes that we'll come back to later, the DNA of artifacts, as it were, history and geography. I'd like to go to Mr. Saxena now with the same question and also pick a statement that Dr. Ahuja said, that our claims with calling for art and sculpture and other materials that are in foreign museums have been very opportunistic. Mr. Saxena, over to you.
So, look, Eric, I mean, you see, ideas can be as complex or as simple as you'd like them to be, right? Now, unlike Dr. Ahuja and Dr. Jain, I'm not a PhD. I've never claimed to have cerebral capacity at all. So for me, the idea is really simple. And as my good friend Ananda Shankar Jayant, Padma Award winner, put it, that history belongs to its geography, right? And I think that's an idea which we should start pushing for more. Now, I'd like to make three very simple points here. But before I do, I'm very uncomfortable with the idea that exceptions, for any idea, for any concept, for any project, you will have exceptions. But that exceptions don't nullify the principle itself. And I think that's something we have to be very conscious of. Now, Three themes that I'd like for us to speak about is, we need to start differentiating between art and heritage. Today, and also private art and private or public art, right? Today, we look at all of this as one monolith, which is where things get complex. The minute you start deconstructing them, then the idea that public heritage was made for certain communities and those communities need them back, that idea becomes much easier palatable and much easier sellable. Second, historically, this subject has been, the whole idea of restitutions, the whole idea of museums, this has fallen under art studies and museum studies. Why has it fallen under art or museum studies? Because people who originally set up universities, which was largely the West, found it convenient to do so. I believe that this is not about museum studies or art studies. This is more, it's about the rights of indigenous communities. Perhaps the rights of communities that have suffered plunder for ages, and which is why I'm very uncomfortable with the whole idea of South Asia, right? I say very proudly, and I'm glad your topic is also called Indian art or Indian heritage, right? So for me, it's a rights issue, not an art studies issue. Third, I really believe that we as a nation need to start flipping the narrative. It is very tempting. Okay, it's very obvious why museums want to frame this as a provenance and a claims issue. And it's very tempting for many of us to get into that obfuscated argument, right? What I'd like to do is to propose an alternate thesis. Now, it will not be bought immediately. It might take years. It might take decades. But for us to actually flip the onus on somebody that owns a piece of cultural property to show consent, to show on what basis are they the legal claimants, other than saying that, hey, listen, I had a gun in my hand, you didn't, so I took it away from you. Now you need to beg and prove that your people need your heritage back, right? I think we've engaged a lot in that kind of weak, pussyfooted approach. And I think it's time for us to flip the onus on the perpetrator rather than the victim. You know, see, as an example, if something that I owned is found in your house, Eric, and you put a label there saying that formerly owned by Anurag, right? The onus should be on you to prove on what basis you took it from Anurag. The onus should not be on Anurag to prove that, hey, listen, I beg you to give this back to me. Here is a set of documents. Here is a lot of diplomatic effort we're putting in, et cetera, et cetera. So just to summarize, I think we need to start differentiating between art and heritage. We need to understand it's not an art studies issue. It's a rights issue, a rights of indigenous communities. And we need to flip the narrative and flip the onus back on museums to prove that whatever they have is legitimately theirs. Now, having said this, there is nothing taking, I'm not taking, and I'm glad, this was an additive point. I'm glad that Jyotindra ji and Naman brought up these whole ideas that India needs to have some kind of a heritage register. I mean, it's shameful that, India is known for its heritage. I mean, nobody comes here to go around the ring road and look at museums and eat, whatever. Right? India is known for its tangible and intangible heritage. And it's shameful we don't have some kind of a list. Forget what's outside, even domestically within India. Right. So there's a lot of domestic issues we need to resolve. But at the same time, I think we really need to flip the argument back. And I'm glad it's happening across, five different countries have started giving back India its heritage, and largely in the last 5-7 years. Right? If you just look at the numbers, and the numbers have been placed in parliamentary proceedings. You've had half a dozen countries that are willingly offer back, Germany, France being the largest examples, and President Macron announced a committee that, look, we need to give back what was stolen. I mean, that's the other issue I have, with no specific reference. When we say that colonizers collected art, no, they didn't collect art. They looted art, they stole art, and sometimes in very gory circumstances. I mean, it's fascinating in London where you have Tipu Sultan's ring, and 20 feet away from it, you have a painting of Tipu Sultan being killed and the ring being taken from his dead body, right? I mean, the paradox of it is just puzzling how that is morally acceptable for you to display something as bloody, as gory as that. So I hope we start changing our narrative and start calling it loot or plunder instead of collection. I hope we change our narrative and say, listen, it's not my job to prove what you stole from me was mine. I mean, you're saying you stole from me, right? It's there, right there on the museum label. So I think we need to start doing that. And some of it is honestly, Eric, is geopolitics. As the strength of nations change, some of that will start happening automatically, as we have seen in the last 5 years, let's say. In the first 65 years of India's independence, we got back only 13 objects, 1-3. That's roughly one every 5 years. In the last 5-6 years, we've got back 41. We're talking of one every 5 years to 41, and that's a huge, right? So, yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Saxena. So we touched some important areas here, history belonging to its geography, as Mr. Saxena says, also that we need to differentiate between art and heritage, and that there is also this moral argument, an argument on ethics. And that's where I want to take, that's where I want to go with this, that there is an argument that relies on ethics and on morals and on our conscience. As Professor Jain has written, how is it that a host of severed sculptural heads of Hindu, Buddhist, and Jain icons are resting uneasy on museum pedestals while their headless counterparts, the torsos, are lying scattered in the distant countries of their origin? And the absurdity of the situation does not shake up our conscience. Volunteers of the Indian Pride Project have scanned London-based museums to capture agony shrieks, holding up thought bubbles in front of sculptures that read, "Ask yourself, how did I get here?" So I would like to go in this direction now, beginning with Dr. Jain. What do you think, Dr. Jain?
there are two things. The Western museums who have, particularly those who colonized and plundered, they have evolved all sorts of strategies which we didn't earlier understand because we were still struggling, and the whole idea of colonial and post-colonial studies was developing. But interestingly, that now they've come up with the idea of decolonization. And this decolonization is this kind of soft decolonization in which the British Museum has floated an idea of universal museum. And they say that, we we create universal museum, and therefore, but you create universal museum because you colonize the universe and you plundered from the universe. Now, the thing is that does it help? And if it is so, and yes, if you think that it's a great ideal and great value in creating, then I'm saying that why don't you create that universal museum in Delhi or in Bombay and send your Picassos and everything here? We will look after. 30 years ago, 40 years ago, things were different. Today, technologically, nothing is difficult. And if we have the will to do that, you know, we also can almost match technical and other facilities if we want to. So I think, and this has been signed by many, nearly 25 vested interest museums who possess this kind of objects in their possession. So I'm saying that returning Naman's issue, that returning to whom? Now, before returning, as I said, first of all, let's have an inventory. Secondly, we can't be lost into legalistic kind of charade, because do they have papers? Do they have papers to show how they took Amravati stupa from here? 122 masterpieces from Amravati, they were removed there from the site. And they said that this is because they were deteriorating in Indian climate. But when they removed from the site and brought to Madras Museum and Madras in Chennai at that time, they were lying there for 30 years under the guidance of the British archaeologists and British government here. After that, when they shifted to London, these pieces, London climate, it is published by themselves, was bad enough to ruin them further. And for nearly 30 to 40 years, they remained in semi-open areas and thing, and they got further deteriorated. They themselves have published it. And after that, they found place in. Now here, what is legal? What papers do they have, you know? And instead of asking all the time the former colonies to produce documentary evidence, I would say, why don't they produce a document saying that this was not plundered? But how did it go there? I think these are many such issues that are involved in this. And the question of what Naman said, returning to whom? Obviously, Pakistan, India, there. But still, you know, art historically and others, you know, art historically itself, we are able to say from where what went. Now, not from which museum, but from which area. I feel that today India is in a position, and I'm not, please don't misunderstand you and your audience. I want to tell that I'm not talking about returning to the nation. I'm not talking about returning to the, it's a very important point, because then it will go into a certain ideological direction and handing over from one dish to putting it into another dish. That I'm not saying, but I think that there is a possibility of bringing it to the society and the community. And one would ask how. I would say yes, the country, government, nation would be the conduit for receiving it back. But it's not that God has said that now that it's come, it is in the hand. You know, if we have the will, we can still think of handing it over to the community. One of the ways, because it's a big issue, so I won't take that much time, but one of the ways, for example, is to create site museums. You know, we have everything centralized in Delhi and Bombay and places like that, and everything is brought from the site. Now, site museum can provide a good context. I'm not saying that, you know, we reconstruct everything and all that, I'm not saying, but at least a site museum, it is at that site. It is that society, those people who speak the same language, those whose ancestors had still worshipped those places. So I think we have to encourage site museum. In India, more than any country in the world, need site museum, because you have hundreds and hundreds of sites where thousands of sculptures are scattered here and there. So we have to create these site museums and decentralize. And if we do that, then in a way, indirectly, we are bringing it to the society, because it can't be brought to the society 400 years ago or 1,000 years ago. We know it all, there's no need to discuss that. But still, You know, it does come from a cultural context. A Khajuraho sculpture does come from Khajuraho area. You know, so even if it is from 50 or 70 kilometers away, still there was a certain art historically stylistic ground and other, you know, from where we can say it belonged to a particular society or so. It won't go back to that particular ritualism and all that, but still. And since the desecularization process was undertaken by archaeological sites that were dug, and then, you know, it was put out of worship and thing. I'm not asking for going back to worship, but I'm saying that a desecularization process happened. Railings were
desacralization.
Desacralization.
Not desecularized.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Desacralized.
So secularization, sorry, no, thanks for that. Secularization process first happened. And after that, once you secularize, you have a right to move it from that place to any place. Hmm. So the object became mobile and started to circulate in different places. So this is how then they went into museums and things like that. And therefore, I think one of the examples is Amravati Stupa. What ground they can say? They talk of legal, aspect, produce document, produce this, that, very Kafkaesque kind of thing that, you know, to put us into that. Now, this one was the 1st century BC to 2nd century AD, this stupa was done, was created. In 1845, it was unearthed by the British archaeologists and thing. And from 1845 to 1859, they remained open in semi-open environment there and in Madras. Later on went to London, as I already mentioned to you. And 3 to 4 decades, it also further underwent damage to them before they were put into British Museum. There are other things also, for example, Victoria and Albert Museum. The kind of things I'm talking about, why there is some justification of returning. They have created a 4-story or more a building in which they have put things that were taken from here to the extent thousands and thousands of things. And when we were taken around, we were told that these objects will not see the light of the day, meaning any exhibition, anything, for 20 years. These won't see light of the day for 40 years. These won't see light of the day. And thousands of these objects are lying, which will never see the light of the day. Meaning how much plunder that has happened. There's no talk about sharing or, you know, and then telling us that, okay, we can lend you these objects. Now, there's a big pitfall in that. You accept that, yes, you lend us this object would mean that we are agreeing that these are your objects, but we are, so we give up the claim on repatriation. So I think this lending part is the trap, and one should think about it.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Jain. So Dr. Jain said something very interesting in the beginning, that you create universal museums because you colonize the universe. And these arguments on world artifacts have been made before. There was a debate on repatriation, and Dr. James Cuno made the argument that artifacts should not be given back, since claims for repatriation of cultural artifacts obtained during the colonial era, are based on an assertion of a shared national identity between objects and the claimant national state. Yeah. But cultural objects, according to him, have no DNA. And even if they did have such a DNA, it would not determine their national identity. I would like to go to Dr. Ahuja.
This is kind of in continuity with what I was saying. I don't deny what Jyotendra was just talking about, and I agree with a lot of those case studies. And I think the exposure of the stories of the neglect of the Amravati stones was allowed and written up by and published by the very institution that houses those sculptures. They themselves have owned up to the neglect that they have caused those images. They have sponsored the research on, the V&A has sponsored the research and and given a platform for that research to show how Indian images have been neglected. They themselves are now aware of this. And when you see somebody talking about it in this manner, it comes from two perspectives as to why they would be doing it, is my opinion. I feel that on the one hand, they're willing to admit that this is the narrative. The British Museum has even taken out manga comic books on repatriation stories and so on and so forth. You know, there are very bold statements that have been taken out on not just soft decolonization, but actually hard stories about what happens with the return and what happens with the denial of the return, and looking at it from multiple perspectives as who the claimants are, what are the reasons for the repatriation. They've talked about these issues quite openly. Are we on the in the same way willing to talk about certain issues also quite openly is the question, that are we actually preparing ourselves adequately to house those objects, to be able to take over the responsibility for the ownership of these things? You know, we are asset rich. And as an asset rich person, you need to be understand that you can be cash poor. You can be, you can have a lot of responsibilities to look after. It's about what you're doing with the assets that is important, right? Ultimately, how you're mobilizing your assets, that should matter. So you'll get it back for your museum, sure, get it back. And then what are you going to do? What are you going to do with it? Like, it means owning more property. Ultimately, you're spending more on looking after it, maintaining it, conserving it. And I think some of these countries, the reason why they are willing to talk about it, as we were just told, I mean, the point is that they themselves are, the balance of power is shifting. And as Mr. Saxena just said, that perhaps if the wealth is coming into these, into our army, coming back into India and China and so on, sure, then India and China have to now start spending on looking after all of these assets as well. And that is going to be a significant demand on the exchequer. Now, when it comes to the track record for what China is doing for the preparation and the maintenance of its cultural heritage and bringing back and buying back if it has to even, but I'm not even getting into that argument. I'm saying, let's just say getting their claim back, getting their claimed objects back, their preparation for their museum sector, the setting up of the art history and the research academies that are going to look after those objects and mobilize those assets rather than actually just having them as responsibilities that are going to be a further drain on the exchequer. The only way the returns from these objects are ever going to add up is that if we start making it matter to the public. So who's going to make it matter? How is it going to be made to matter? Under what narratives? Who are the people? So the solutions-based approach to the problem has to be thought through. And what I like about today's conversation is that it's not doing the usual of saying that there's been theft. And yes, there has. So now what are you going to do about it? And to be able to get the object back, what is your preparation? And how many people do you have to look after it? And where is the hiring being done? And how is the expansion being managed? And I think these are urgent things that we need to do if we are actually going to be serious about filing claims. Our claims are going to have to be met. So as Dr. Jain was saying, we need the site museums, as he said. We need these solutions-based approaches to be immediately put in place where the infrastructural development for all of these things is put in place. The provenance research, as he is saying, until it is mobilized and put into place, we're just talking. And our talking is getting us some amount of media coverage, but it's not getting us anything more. And if all we want out of this entire exercise is a bit of media publicity, then sure, we can carry on with this chasing our tail and going round and round. But if we are really serious about our claim and getting our things back, then I think we should be putting into place certain measures, and those measures will actually count for a lot more, because we will have the infrastructure necessary to be able to get these things back, as well as look after what we have. Yeah. Now, the reason why the Argumentative Indians platform has staged today's debate, and I think we've all leapfrogged the fundamental premise of today's conversation, has been the fact is implicit in the question that has been asked is that, are our objects better off in museums abroad? And that is the question that we have not, none of the three of us speakers have addressed squarely yet.
Yeah, but we are coming towards it, like what you said.
And I think unless we get to that solutions-based approach, where we are admitting the lacunae in our own governance and in our own establishment and our infrastructure in the heritage sector, until we are willing to say that, so we are saying, yes, we will put these solutions in place so that we can say that these things are not better off in foreign museums. But are we, therefore, the three of us saying that until such time that we get our house in order, they are better off in foreign museums? Is that what we are saying?
May I? Naman?
Yeah. Yes, Dr. Jain. Yeah. Then we'll just come to Mr. Saxena. Yes, Dr. Jain.
Shall I?
Yes, Dr.
Now, I agree with all what Naman said, but what we are discussing is that let us make a beginning somewhere. All these problems are not insurmountable. Yeah, they are difficult. They'll take time. But still, I think if you think of European curiosity cabinet century to today, they have also sort of upgraded, gone, thought a lot about preservation, looking after, researching, building up texts around objects. You know, we have not even begun. My point is that we have not even begun. And therefore, there is a need for some kind of institution attached either to university, to a museum, or as a special wing in the Ministry of Culture, or even independently attached to a private major cultural institution, to start thinking about it, creating inventories, talking about what will happen if objects begin to come. They're not going to come so soon. If Greek marbles didn't go back over 50, 30 years, they won't go. But it doesn't mean that we don't even make a beginning. And we have never made a beginning. We are talking only about whether the objects are better off abroad. If they are better off abroad, then let us send the rest of the objects also to them to look after. Or there are, and what I'm now saying, I'm aware that is highly exaggerated, but there are many poor children in India, and maybe they'll be looked after better abroad. Are we going to do that? We have to make a beginning somewhere, and also that to have access to our own object is so difficult. I don't know, Naman had lived in London many years, so he might have friends and found access. I found it very difficult, and I've spoken to many scholars who find very difficult to get access to for research, etc., and to go there and to sit there. Very few people manage to go and study those objects. And after all, there's a possibility to begin. I don't see any of the, in case the objects begin to come back, it's not difficult for India to create an infrastructure. It's not difficult. I think site museum is one aspect, but even so, and there can be somewhere thing, they won't come in one go or one day. So, you know, we can begin to create infrastructure. India has created a lot of infrastructure in the last 30, 40 years. We can create this kind of intellectual as well as physical infrastructure to receive and to begin to prepare inventories of objects and things. So I think that the need is to believe in it and start somewhere, make a beginning somewhere and make a plan. Like Naman said, that we have to think about how, so we have to make a plan. Suppose it happened, what will happen? So you have to organize an institute, you have to hire at least 15-20 people who think about it and things and prepare a report that itself can take a couple of years to do before we put a claim. You know, there are a lot of things, but not to begin anywhere, not even just to start. And all you see, after the French president made a speech in 2017 in Burkina Faso, where he said that colonialism is a crime against humanity. And he said, he promised in African countries that I will return, French museums will return their object. That speech has made such an impact that they themselves have started symbolically, but at least 40 Benin bronzes they have returned. Other museums are nervous. Every 15 days, The Guardian, Washington Post, The New York Times, and others, they are writing articles saying that British Museum is shivering. The other day, 15-20 days ago, a German museum began to return, and the headline said, the Germans are returning, so the British are frightened, and you know, they are nervous about it, because there is an ethical angle. So I think if we don't even make a beginning, so I think we have to work towards it privately, in government, wherever. But I think we have not started doing anything. Can't depend on government alone. But such debate as we have, what Naman said, what Anurag said, what Eric has sort of facilitated dialogue, even this is a, and what we are all saying, it is a beginning. And many such things have to happen to make a kind of create an environment in which such voices will become louder and louder, and also not louder voices, but also begin to prepare some kind of practicable plan.
Yes. So Dr. Jain says that we need to start somewhere. We need to make a beginning. And earlier, Dr. Roja was saying that, but we also need to make it matter to the people of this country. So I'd like to now bring in Mr. Saxena.
So, look, I think very interesting points here. Most I agree with, a couple I don't. Now, you know, Dr. Jain talked about various articles in Guardian and New York and the New York Post and all of that. Now, and I'm linking that back to what Naman said a short while back. You know, there was this fascinating article in the Washington Post, which compared China's approach to India's approach, specifically the Summer Garden Project, to the project that I run, the India Pride Project, which basically talked about the ideological rooting of these two approaches. One of these approaches, the article said, the Chinese approach is premised on, hey, I'm stronger than you, so I'll either buy back or steal back whatever I can from you, right? Which is a reversal of, it's the same affront, but the direction is reversed. Versus the India Pride Project or the India approach, which is more premised on the moral conversation or the ethical angle, which is a little more sustainable, I think. So that makes a very interesting comparison, because as much as, you know, the fact is India and China are fundamentally different, structurally different nations and civilizations. So there's stuff they can do which we can't, and vice versa. Now, coming to this whole idea of, hey, listen, India needs to get ready before we can prove to the world that we can take care of our own heritage. You know, I'd like us to be a little more Gandhian about it and quote what Mahatma Gandhi said to Winston Churchill, where he said, hey, listen, we know there's a bunch of things that are problems, but they are India's problem for Indians to resolve. So I don't think we should even entertain the notion that our infrastructure is somehow not as great. I mean, you know, I think as Jyotinderji said, you know, Dr. Balfour talked about how the Amravati marbles were disintegrated. And this was like, 150, 200 years back. So let's not entertain this argument that, hey, listen, we'll kidnap your mother because you're a terrible son, and we'll take care of your mother. I think, that's an argument we should not entertain. And look, I mean, reality is, India has been through a very steep phase of economic prosperity. Of, you know, let's not forget that India and Indians are coming out of collective PTSD, right? For centuries, there has been an onslaught by people from the Middle East and the French and the Portuguese and finally the British, right? So we're discovering our own self-confidence only now, right? And we're building our nation only now. I mean, you know, when Jyotindra ji was as young as you, Eric, he had to wait for 6 months to get a Bajaj Chetak, right? When I was as young as you, Eric, I had a choice between a Bajaj Chetak and an LML Vespa. You today have a choice between, you know, 50 bikes and perhaps can even dream of buying a car yourself, which I can't. You know, I'm not bringing in Naman here because he has his personal jet and all of that. So Naman's context is very different here. But you see, as a nation, we are just finding our self-worth after suffering trauma for centuries, right? And we will take time to build our own infrastructure, and that's fine. I mean, it's our heritage. We'll take care of it the way we deem appropriate. Now, that doesn't give anybody else the right. So, you know, obfuscating the ethical conversation and changing into an infrastructure conversation, I think personally is very dangerous. Sure, we need to build better sites. Sure, we need to have better policing. Sure, we need better documenting. And, you know, the across healthcare, education, human rights, blah, blah, blah. There's a lot that India needs to do, and culture is one of them, and we will do them. But that doesn't give anybody else the right to say that we'll kidnap your mother or we'll kidnap your child, because we guarantee we'll take better care of them. Because guess what? History has proven that you cannot take better care of them anyways. Right. So I don't know. That's, I find it a very slippery slope. So I just thought, and as you can see, I do get worked up about this. And, you know, very interestingly, just quick last point, I know I've been rambling for a while. 3 or 4 weeks back, I was speaking at the UNESCO annual convention. And I found it very interesting that across the board, there was a general consensus that it is time to decolonize museums. It is time for indigenous communities to reclaim their right. Doesn't matter if they have an AC glass cabinet or not, because guess what? That heritage was not meant to be in an AC glass cabinet to begin with. That wasn't its original purpose. So why are we worrying about it? And I think, you know, I'm glad that, you know, I, my team, and others on this panel as well, I'm sure, have become part of changing that conversation. Look, 10 years back, media wasn't talking about it, right? Today you have the BBC and the Diplomat and the Washington Post and the Times of India, blah, 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 talking about it. And that's important. 10 years back, it wasn't a mudda for politicians. Today we have not just people from the BJP, but from the Congress and the Telugu Desam and the AIDMK that are standing up and asking this question in Parliament. You know, 10 years back, we didn't have these conversations happening, Eric. But today we have these conversations happening. 10 years back, people like me were dismissed as an unnecessary hindrance or noise. Today we are mainstream, right? And I think that's the good news for me. And I think we have to keep our eye on that ball to focus on the ethical conversation, to focus on the moral conversation, and not get it diluted away by the obfuscation that the museums want to talk about. Hey, let's talk about provenance. Hey, let's talk about, you know, how shit your museums are back home, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, it's pitiable that I have to go to buy a ticket, go all the way to London to look at something that was stolen from my grandfather. And then you send me a shoddy replica for $35 in the British Museum shop. That should be unacceptable. And I think, I know that the organizers have watched this, Eric. I mean, there was this fascinating documentary on this subject called Blood Buddhas. If you haven't seen Blood Buddhas, I would urge each of you to see Blood Buddhas. I think it's the only documentary being made on the restitution of Indian art and heritage. And it starts with this gentleman, I think Mr. Patel, who's in his late 60s, a resident of London, who every Monday morning, he starts his week by going into the British Museum and doing a Sashtang Pranam in front of a murti that was stolen away from his ancestors, from his village. And I think that's a very powerful, and the man has been doing it for the last, you know, 20, 30, 40 years. And that's a powerful visual of what this heritage was supposed to mean. It was never meant to be a showpiece. And that's the conversation. And again, I'm shout out again to Nikhil Singh, who made this bold movie. The movie is called Blood Buddhas. Please watch it. And I think that's the conversation we should be having, not on the tactical aspects of heritage maintenance. I mean, that conversation needs to happen domestically. So there's, I'm not being in denial here. That's a domestic conversation that happens once the ethical case has been established.
Does Dr. Ahuja, you were coming in?
So I think the ethical question is equally a part of our infrastructural question, because if we are, it's not about obfuscating, and we are having a domestic conversation. We are not having an international conversation here. And I think our question is that, I mean, let me just clarify. I mean, I was 21 and I was on a scholarship to be able to go and study Indian art history. And I went for my visa interview to the British High Commission in Delhi. And I had a mocking visa interviewer ask me that, you're going to Britain to be able to study Indian art, and you think that's a valid reason for me to give you a visa? And I was so stunned that I was being asked this question that I actually did not have a private jet on which I could arrange this matter, but I was actually, it was so hard to get that scholarship and to be able to put the money together to be able to study my art. And here I was at a visa interview where I was being asked this very taunting question. And I turned it around to the visa interviewer officer. And I remember it's become the stuff of family legend, because everyone in my family completely sort of laughs about this story and jokes and pokes fun at me and said that how I turned around and said to the visa officer that, why are you asking me that question? Shouldn't you be asking yourself as to why I need to go to your country to be able to study my art? So I'm afraid these assumptions that are made about our cultural patrimony and all the rest of it, these are things that we have lived through. We're not denying those things. But some of us who work in the profession are actually trying to counsel on the perspective to say that we've also fought the battle to be able to bring things back to India. And we've seen what happens to them in India. We've worked with the British Museum and those institutions to gain the knowledge that they have, both tactically to be able to see how they create their narrative, how do they defend their own possession, what do they need to do to be answerable to their own parliament. We've seen it from the inside. We wish to do something similar on the Indian front. We are here to be able to do things on the Indian front. We're not obfuscating a conversation. We're trying to say very clearly that something needs to be done urgently over here, because our infrastructural development cannot be put away on the grounds of rhetoric to be able to, like I said previously, if this is merely an exercise to be able to make public awareness, to be able to get some more media shout outs, then we are where we are. We'll stay stuck where we are because our claim will never gain credibility. But if our claim has to gain credibility, then the methods by which these assets are going to be mobilized need to be put in place, because without that, it's empty clamoring for the sake of just getting a few more TPRs or whatever it is that we do. So if we have to move beyond that, then what are the actionables that are going to, and that's why the conversation was very productively moving towards solutions-based things. And the solutions-based thing within it had an implicit acknowledgement on one side of the debate, which was the premise of this question, which is that, whereas we are agreeing that something has been amiss and remiss in the way in which Indian museums have been looking after their objects and heritage. And since that has not been going in place, you as a platform are inviting us to talk before and against, for and against a motion, which is that, are they better off abroad? Now, all of us are on the side to say that, yes, actually we would not like them to be better off abroad. But the point is, therefore, implicit in our conversations is the point that, how are we going to make a claim to get them back? How are we going to make a claim to be able to look after what we have, and what are we going to do with that heritage in our own environment? And I think that's the direction that we certainly need to move in very productively and strongly, urgently, because the threat to the heritage is not a threat which is merely coming in from the foreign museum and the old narrative of colonization. I think the biggest threats that are happening at the moment to the largest quantities of our heritage are coming because of a hyper-urbanization, which is the spread of our own urban infrastructure into arenas from where these objects are actually coming out, where the habitats are being transformed, where the colonizer is not some external person. The colonizing tendency is within. It is our own development as who we are that is causing the greatest threat to historical heritage. Now, can that heritage today be sacrificed because of our development? I am not saying that our development needs to stop. It can't stop. Even if I wanted it and you wanted it and we love nostalgia, we can't stop development and progress. It's going to happen. But what we can do, at least to be able to prevent the losses that will come with it, is to be able to create the infrastructure urgently to keep housing and mobilizing the things that we are collecting. And that is not happening at a fast enough pace. So instead of righting the wrongs that have happened 100 years back, which I'm not saying are atrocities that don't need to be righted, I'm not at all saying it's not an either or, but are we acknowledging the what is happening right now? Because we need to be fixing this in any case. So if we are doing that, and if our love is actually for the heritage, not for the narrative of colonial wrongs, if our love is for the heritage, then what are we doing first for the protection, the infrastructure, the development within our own? And that equips us adequately, not just to protect what we have, but even to make our claims, to be able to get back. So I think the threat is to equally recognize that the objects that have been lost, stolen, taken away, have not just happened in till 1947. They continued to take place post-independence. And why were they taking place? And why are they taking place even now? Why is it continuing to happen? What is the driving engine behind that loss? Why is the theft continuing? And the driving engine behind that theft and that loss is because we are inadequately mobilizing the protection of that heritage within our own society. And if we are not doing enough for it within our own culture, then we really can't make a claim for somebody else to be complicit, to be writing something, you know, because we are not writing it. And that's why ethically, morally, we have to be able to look at ourselves and say, because we were poor, we didn't do it then. Okay, now you're not poor. I mean, you are not now. So why aren't you doing it now? And so we have to be, even with poverty, there has to be a greater awareness, is what I'm trying to say. And we have to protect our sites better. We have to be more aware of what is being taken out of our sites. Who's paying for it? How much are they willing to pay for it? Why are they willing to pay so much for it? How is it leaving the country? Why is it that when there are so many wealthy people within the country, why aren't they buying it? Why aren't they setting up the museums just as they would be somewhere else? What's happening? You know, why are those things not happening over here? And I think those solutions to address the problems and then address the solutions as to, are they better off in foreign museums or would they be better off in Indian museums, can then be actually addressed. We would be admitting and fixing, taking a solutions-based approach to the problem. So
yeah,
I hope we can start not looking at it as a distraction of the ethical with the infrastructural, because it isn't. I think a lot of us are committed to the cause of actually the protection of this material, but these are genuine obstacles that those of us in the field face on how we can actually start fixing the problem. And I hope it can be heard.
Yes. So before I hand over to Mr. Saxena, I'd just like to pick an argument that Dr. Ahuja made, which I'm linking to this argument that happened on Scroll in 2016 on Amaravati Stupas between Dr. Ruchika Sharma and Dr. Kavita Singh. And there is this question of threat at home too with mismanagement and infrastructure, because yes, there is this moral argument of getting these antiquities back. At the same time, when they come back here, then is there a threat that follows? So I'll now give it over to Mr. Saxena.
So, I'm going to make three quick points. I mean, first of all, Naman, obviously, once you get to know me better, you know that I have this terrible ability to misplace humor. So I was just being facetious when I talked about your private plane. It wasn't meant to be. It was nothing more than that, right? Now, second, on the whole obfuscation bit, I was directly referring to the argument museums abroad use. Doesn't matter what view we have on this panel, right? I mean, historically, museums have always tried to throw the ball back in your court. Instead of answering the simple question which Jyotindra ji raised, which is, okay, you show me the document how you got so-and-so object, right? So that's the obfuscation which museums use, which we should be very, very wary about and not even engage in, I think. Third quick comment is, again, the moral argument and the infrastructure argument needn't be sequential or needn't be conditional on one another. My view here is that both these need to happen now, today, in parallel, right? If we keep waiting, you see, a country the size of India is never going to solve all its challenges in our lifetime. So that's not going to happen. There's never going to be an ideal time for us to make not just a case for heritage, but a case for anything, right? So, that's all that I'm saying. Now, coming back to this whole question of, do we take care of our heritage better? Again, it's a very tempting thought, and I think that thought plays in more on stereotype rather than on fact. We've had cases abroad of museums getting burned down, of museums getting stolen, of our objects like the Amravati objects. Starting 1853, they've been documenting why the Palnad marbles, as they're called, why it was a terrible idea to even take Palnad marbles into the British weather conditions, etc. There've been cases of damage within museums or within museum storerooms. So there's been a lot of, I think sometimes we're just bitten by the idea of the progressive West, watching Hollywood, Bollywood movies. Now look, on an average, museums there are in a better condition in terms of infrastructure, right? I mean, which is what got me into, like Naman left for the UK at age 21, I left for the US on a similar scholarship and a similar visa experience, right? And one of the things was General Patton's house. The house was not even as old as my nani ghar, right? And then you had audio tours and brochures and, blah, 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 which is what got me thinking about why we look at our heritage so terribly. But let's not assume because, we've read British fiction and watched American museums. Let's not assume that heritage is better off there, right? I mean, there's enough documentation. B, I absolutely agree with Naman here, not just urbanization. So urbanization, the law and order situation, rampant thefts, there's a lot of issues for us to fix domestically as well. Now, that doesn't mean we ignore the rights issue of heritage, right? So, and not for a moment should we assume that that theft or damage or arson or whatever doesn't happen with global heritage in the UK, in the US, anywhere else. I mean, that's another story that has been served. We've bought it.
I mean, the terrorist attacks that are happening all over the world and the kind of floods that have happened in the V&A's basement the kind of damage to Roman heritage that has happened in the city of London. So there are major case studies of how they themselves have encountered these kinds of problems, which is why they've also had to create the laws and the infrastructure that they did. Like with the Amravati marble story that we were just talking about. The point is that, as you said, as Balfour raised this own story and others have talked about it, where they shamed their own government into action and saying, what was the point of bringing these treasures from India if they're going to be lying on the East India docks and be mistreated in this manner? So they managed to put their house in order, because remember, the government even there was not wanting to spend these astronomical sums of money on fixing their museums and creating all of this and spending that money from the exchequer. The media and the public had to make a hue and cry. So if you speak to people in the field who actually work in the art and archaeology and art history industry and in conservation, even in those countries, they will tell you how they have been able to make a space for their museums to function. Now, what I'm trying to get at is that similarly, we need to get on, pull our socks up to be able to hold our institutions accountable and to be able to leverage a certain amount of money for and the training of personnel, because we may even have cash, but we may not have personnel in the country. And I think that's one of our biggest problems once we recognize that. So when the opportunity came for us to be able to host an exhibition in India where the British Museum agreed to lend its treasures from its Universal Museum to India for the edification and the betterment of Indians, to be able to also assuage itself from its colonial guilt and its issues of owning all of this cultural heritage. You see, the thing was that in the project collaborative structure that was worked out, it was not a dialogue merely of the British Museum lending India the objects. We made it very clear, you lend us the skill and the infrastructure that your graphic designer will work with our graphic designer, your lighting engineer will work with our lighting engineer, not just your curator will work with our curator, which was my designation in a project like that. But it was actually to have capacity building and sharing, where you are creating a cadre of professionals where the terms of engagement and collaboration are actually being worked out for a co-production of knowledge and capacity building. We said that the narrative has to move beyond that you didn't just steal our art. You're not just giving back our art. You're also now responsible for giving back the knowledge systems and the production methods and the lighting and the infrastructural facilities that come along with the 200 years of the experience of the ownership of the object. Don't expect us that 200 years of ownership of an object have given you a certain kind of knowledge base. So of how to look after these things, your institutions are 200 years older than ours to know what to do in such situations. Your PR department is 200 years older than our PR department. There is a certain institutional memory that you are working with. And our institutional memory, therefore, needs to catch up and be aware of some of these polemics and to be aware of these infrastructural developments to be able to know what different sectors of that museum do. It's not merely the ownership of the object. That is asset. What are you doing about the management of the asset? And how is the knowledge of the management of the asset becoming a shared experience in the co-production of the knowledge that is being leveraged by that asset is as important in the upping of the talent rather than leaving us talent poor, but then again, once again, asset rich, waiting to be lose the asset once more, only leaving you vulnerable as a vulnerable owner once more. And there has to be a way to be able to make us an equally strong owner of the asset. So I hope that we can continue with a conversation that will be moving in this direction, not just to point a finger at what went wrong in the past, because we are learning from history to be able to do something better for the future. And I think the conversation is, what are we leveraging? How are we mobilizing this knowledge for what we are doing in our own house? I think Jyotendra has been wanting to come in into
yes,
this
conversation. So Dr. Jain, please go ahead.
You know, after the antiquity law was put in place, all what went or is going is a police and legal issue. But colonial thing is a political issue. And that's where we need a certain kind of will, one thing. Coming to infrastructure, to say that there are two things. One is, if the things have to come back and we don't have infrastructure, that's one aspect, or we are not capable of creating an infrastructure in our time is another issue. I do not feel that we are not able to create infrastructure. And why must it be only, the infrastructure must come only from India? It can be international. It can be, say, for conservation, restoration, these lighting, whatever where we need help, it is internationally available. So we are not dependent on those museums alone who possess our antiquity. So I think the whole issue is that if this matter is sort of taken away from the bureaucratic thing about making museum, another museum, 10 more museum, 20 more museum to create in the country, instead of that, somewhere this voice has to reach. And for that, I think we have to have some forum, some institution where it can come, because today there are private universities, there are private institutions who are willing to put in a lot of money if there's a meaningful cause. So we can make a beginning. All what we discussed can be, more people can be involved. We can prepare one basic paper, what needs to be done and things. But I think that I see it so easy to create both intellectual and physical infrastructure for being able to receive things back when, as and when. But first of all, to ask for those things, to have our inventory, because all other countries are doing it. We always thought African countries, you know, we thought, well, when they will wake up. All 33 countries have staked a claim, you know, and we are not even in a position to stake a claim. By the time it's done, simultaneously, we can't do it one by one. We can also think about infrastructure, for example, while preparing inventories or things like that. So if there is a central place where people are involved in thinking about and preparing a blueprint, then one can take it up. It would take perhaps years, you know, till when it can be, but we have not even begun, whereas many countries have already begun to ask, you know, like Angkor Wat, for example. They have already identified so many statues where the heads were abroad and bodies were, and a beautiful book has come out by an Angkor scholar, in which he has identified heads which are separate somewhere in collection, private or museum, and identified the torsos. And he has said that those people who were collectors, they said, yeah, sorry, we are happy to give it back, so to put it on the torso. I'm not saying that always such literal things are possible, but what I'm saying is that they have made a beginning and things are happening. So I think we need to start somewhere. We have not even begun. And begun doesn't mean only inventory. Inventory is one aspect you have to have. Infrastructure is another aspect. How are we going to do? What are we going to do? Is it site museum? Do we need intellectual infrastructure? What will happen if things begin to come? After all, there are such a lot of projects in the air with huge spaces available where all sorts of museums are to be put. So, you know, spaces and things, it's not, but we haven't got, except that we are discussing here or occasionally an article here and there. There's no way we are closer to tell the world that, or the government, because government will be involved, to say that we, this is what some preliminary blueprint is. Can we work towards it? Even that we don't.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jain. Now, I'd love for this conversation to go on for longer, but that so because we're running out of time, I'd just like to invite final remarks from Mr. Saxena and Dr. Ahuja, and then we can conclude.
Yes.
Mr. Saxena, over to you.
I think, in my view, the minute we start making the conversation or narrative or challenge more complex than it is, the chances of it seeing light of day decrease, right? We're working against the Lindy effect, as we call it in the world of economics, which is the longer an idea has survived, the longer it will take to change. Now, the idea that might is right, the idea that, I'm proud of what your grandfather stole from mine, these ideas have survived for ages, right? The Western narrative machine, and I'm not saying that there is some global conspiracy or anything like that. You've looked at Indiana Jones and Robert Langdon as heroes, right? But once you flip the lens, one could ask you, okay, who gives Indiana Jones the right to walk into an indigenous community and take whatever he felt like? I mean, I say this very often. I mean, Indiana Jones is the biggest con that Steven Spielberg pulled off on us.
No. In archaeology institutes, actually, they do a critique. It's one of the criticisms of how the students are taught. Look at Indiana Jones movies to tear them apart.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think we need to take that conversation out to the world here. I mean, this has been normalized for so long that just flipping that lens itself will take a lot of effort. So I'm personally more keen on how that lens gets flipped. While at the same time, I've been writing op-eds on these for ages as an example. Here are the 5 things or here are the 10 things the government of India needs to do. We need to have an art and heritage police like we have a cyber wing. We need to have a national registrar of heritage assets. We need to have way stronger legislation. And, the Monuments Bill was modified a couple of years back. The Antiquities Bill still wasn't. We need to have, it's shameful that there is no art or heritage education as part of our core curriculum in schools. We need to make people more aware of that. So there's a bunch of things that needs to domestically happen. At the same time, we need to flip the narrative internationally. We need to be a little more self-confident and call out loot for what it was, to call out an atrocity for what it was, and make a very simple case when it comes to colonial art, right? That, look, as the Brits, you took 3 things from us. You took our lives, you took our resources, you took our heritage. Now, there's no way you can give back our lives or our resources. The least you can do, as a penance for your forefathers' sins, is to give back our heritage. And I think that's the case we need to make a little more boldly. Over to
Thank you, Mr. Saxena. Over to you, Dr. Ahuja.
I agree with Dr. Jain that provenance studies is extremely important. And colonial appropriation, as well as the takeover of Tibet by China, the raiding of temples and monasteries, the discarding of objects in festivals, or whatever the reason for the trajectory of the objects for coming into a museum have been, are very much part of each object's histories. And as somebody who is invested in the research on the provenance of objects and seeing their trajectories, this actually comes up with surprisingly varied kinds of histories which are extremely important, which are not, and I want to make it clear, which are not distracting us from the issue, because every bit of work that the museum does to enable the stories around the objects makes the museum's claim on the object actually more powerful. The reason why the museum is so powerful, it won't lose the object. the museum only becomes more and more powerful because it is leveraging greater knowledge and relevance around the artifact. And as these museums continue to win the game of relevance everywhere else in the world, our museums are not being able to keep pace because we are not leveraging the same relevance for our objects in the international museum arena, because our objects have become repositories. The only narrative that we are able to invest in them is that it is a cultural patrimony of our faith, which has gone elsewhere. Whereas actually that's not always a secure footing. There are 10 other narratives that can be mobilized even in provenance studies for each of these objects other than colonial looting. There are provenance studies will lead to the narrative of colonial looting, agreed, but it will also open up 10 other narratives which will come with provenance studies. And that is not taking away from the narrative of colonial looting. It is adding 10 more layers and it is making the museum 10 times more powerful. And each narrative opens up a new relevance for a museum going and heritage loving public. And that heritage loving public, as we said, as Mr. Saxena also just pointed out, actually at the end of the day, art and the heritage belongs to those who can demonstrate that they love it. Loving it means being responsible for taking care of it, right? You take care of what you love. Being able to show that you can share it and use it to inspire not just the creators of more art, but inspire society more widely. Every single person on this panel has claimed on the panel itself to have published articles that have indicated how the museums can do that, how heritage has the capacity to be able to do that. So where is the argument then about the premise of this conversation, right? Which is that certainly the objects are very well off within South Asia, and we should be getting the heritage back. We need to mobilize these narratives within South Asia. And there are many fronts on which this needs to be done. It is not merely a narrative of colonial loot. It is actually a narrative on multiple fronts of neglect. And each of those narratives is equally powerful. And each of those narratives must be looked at. That's my contention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ahuja. Dr. Jain, any last words from you?
No, I think we have discussed things, but one thing to add to Naman, which he was saying between the lines, and maybe I put the focus on the thing. That is one reason why our museums have come to this state. One of the reasons is that it is more often bureaucratization than professionalization. It's not that in our country, all our art history departments, the JNU School of Arts and Aesthetic, and many other things put together, individuals all over India, it's not that we don't have a fair number of professionals who think differently. But finally, if the bureaucratization is so much that every little thing that is done, or if the bureaucracy, the service bureaucracy, is going to decide on things, I think, and take a couple of examples of our museum, just start counting National Museum, take other large museum, except Bombay's former Prince of Wales Museum. It is how many professionals are there? Just count how many art historians have worked there. Hardly any. A National Museum like Grace, you don't even have 3 people who are really, there were people but who retired, but not even 3 people you can say who are really experts at a certain area, and that they are really, their work is of certain weightage. It doesn't happen. And not to talk of other smaller museums. Everywhere they are under bureaucratic control. So I think we need to professionalize museums. Besides all other things, infrastructure development, all that is safe. But if we say, are we capable? I think we would have been a little more capable had it been professionalization than bureaucratization.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jain. And thank you everyone for joining us today. I'm extremely honored to have moderated this session. And I'd like to extend my warmest thanks to Dr. Jain, Dr. Ahuja, and Mr. Saxena for joining us and sharing their viewpoints. We touched some important themes: history and geography, creation of inventories, whether we return objects to nations or communities, colonial guilt and looting, the problems with lending, infrastructure, management, universal museums, site museums, and also some interesting anecdotes reminding me of my youth, but at the same time, giving me the assurance that art history is what I'm sticking with. But again, on a serious note, all of these themes that we touched upon today, we hope leave room for more insightful conversations to happen. A huge thanks to also our viewers for tuning in today and being an integral part of this conversation. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Eric, so much for so wonderfully conducting the session.
Yeah, really.
Anurag, was nice to
talk to you.
Yeah, sir.
Naman,
thank you very much.
Pick my phone.